There is peace in his presence. Ask and the door will be opened to you. His presence is palpable. Run towards him. Nothing can separate you from the love of your Father.
Presence this morning. Thank you for opening our eyes to see you. Thank you for a fresh drink. Thank you, Lord, for freedom. Come Come on, is there something you need to thank him for this morning?
Thank you, Lord.
There probably is, because every good, acceptable, and perfect gift has come from him.
Hallelujah.
It came from him. You're not sure where it came from. I can tell you it came from him. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. I just want to invite Pastor Chuck Freeman. He's going to be speaking this morning. You guys thought I was preaching, didn't you? Next week, we're going to have Cliff Ostrander and Steve Swartz leading worship and preaching. And so we're not going to be here. We're going on vacation. Just want to let you know it's a combined service next week. Come for prayer. Come in advance. If you're not sure about what's happening and you want to always stay in touch, you need to get our app. If you don't have the app, you're going to miss information. If something's going to change and you're going to wonder what happened, you're going to walk in and the service is already going to be rolling. And you're going to be, what's going on? I could tell you. So for all you I'm scared of Big Brother people, you need to get the app. Just get it. It's not tracking you. Okay? So, at this time I just want to welcome Pastor Chuck, and he's going to bring the word. And can we just honor him? Can you just welcome him this morning? Come on.
There we go. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
You ever had the experience of having lived in a house for quite a while and then selling it and moving on, and then the owners of the house invite you to come back to see what it looks like? I have that same experience here, because our church had been in this building for a number of years. Robin and I came to Cortland area in 2005. Which is remarkable to me, because we've never lived anywhere that long. And Homer Baptist, and then became Grace Christian Fellowship. We were there for 4 years. And then a fellow named John Cobb and I talked about starting a church, started in my house, called it Mosaic. We were in rented space for a while, and then we bought this place. And I got to tell you, I won't tell you who we bought it from, maybe you already know who used to be here, but we came in after we signed the papers for this building. We had a whole crew of people with magic markers, thick black magic markers, and we went through the whole building writing scriptures on the walls. We prayed over this building, we dedicated this building to the Lord, because I don't know about those who are in here before us. And so we did that we worshiped here with all the upstairs, downstairs, and we left it like that for a while until we eventually did paint that, and we prayed over every room. So this is a building that's dedicated to God, and you can sense the presence of God in this place. I got to say to you that it's not the building, it's the people, because he comes because you're here. Where two or three gathered in my name, I will be there in their midst. And so it's exciting to me that to see what's happening here. You folks, the presence of God, the worship, your enthusiasm and passion for the things of God, it just excites me to see that continues on in this building. We've been at the chapel now we just had our 10 years. I don't even know if they know about it there, but we're going to be retiring a year from now. I work at McGraw High School as well. In fact, Robin used to work at Child Developmental Center, and she's pointing to some of the kids here. She says, I remember that kid. That he or she was one of my babies at one time. She had oversight of the baby unit at Child Developmental Center. So, yeah, thank you for inviting me. Inviting both of us here, it's a real honor to be able to come and share the word with you. We're going to be looking at Daniel chapter 1 this morning. And why is the book of Daniel so important to us? Because I think it's vital. It's vital to our own lives as well. Well, why? In the book of Daniel, we're reminded that in the midst of great turmoil, our God reigns. Do you hear what I say? Even in the Daniel shows us, even in the midst of great turmoil, God still reigns. And he's to be turned to in faith. He's to be trusted without fear and worshiped and praised because of who he is. Daniel is an account of people being faithful to God in the midst of extreme situations. It's also, most importantly, that the life of Daniel is recorded that in the Old Testament gives evidence to God's faithfulness in the midst of everything. Whether it was in the lion's den, whether it was in the fiery pit with Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, God's faithfulness stood supreme. Now, if you read the book of Daniel chapter by chapter, you'll find that when God calls you to a faith action, especially when it's not convenient, he doesn't expect you to go it alone. And we see that for all throughout the book of Daniel. Your act of obedience and submission to him can affect, also, we find so many others. And it can be outwardly visible to many, which happened in the life of Daniel. But I want to give this premise. It doesn't write about this in Daniel. But to me, some of the greatest acts of faith is when no one else is watching except him. And so Daniel chapter 1 is really not only the foundation for Daniel and his friends when it comes to faith action, but you need to hear me this morning why this is so important. Because it's also the vital foundation for your and my acts of faith, of faithful obedience to him. That's why it's so important to us. So let's look at Daniel chapter 1. It's quite lengthy. I'm going to do the first 16 verses, but it's really important to get this. During the third year of King Jehoiakim, his reign in Judah, King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon came to Jerusalem and besieged it. The Lord gave him victory over King Jehoiakim of Judah and permitted him to take some of even the sacred objects from the temple of God. So Nebuchadnezzar took them back to the land of Babylon and placed them in his own treasure house of his gods. Now, let me say this. Nebuchadnezzar invaded Jerusalem because at the time, Jerusalem and Israel was being held by Egypt. And Egypt had unsuccessfully attacked Babylon. And so King Nebuchadnezzar came and took over Jerusalem and drove out the Egyptians. But it was really God who had put Jerusalem into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar. It was prophesied back in Isaiah 39:7, and his reasons was that there was tremendous idolatry among the Jews and their failure to respect and observe the Sabbath. And so God put the Jews into the hands of Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon. Also, it was interesting that Nebuchadnezzar taking the sacred objects was his way of saying to the Jews, listen, my gods are greater than yours. And to me, that was a holy setup because God was going to show them something completely different in the season ahead. Verse 3, then the king ordered Ashpenaz, his chief of staff, to bring to the palace some of the young men of Judah's royal family and other notable families who had been brought to Babylon as captives. Select only strong, healthy, good-looking young men, he said. Make sure they're well-versed and every branch of learning, who are gifted with knowledge and good judgment and are suited to serve the royal palace. Train these young men in the language and literature of Babylon. The king assigned them a daily ration of food and wine from his own kitchens, and they were to be trained for 3 years, and then they would enter royal service. Listen, taking the best and the brightest from Jerusalem was really his way of ensuring that those back in Jerusalem would not revolt against him. In some ways, he was holding them as captive. Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were the four young men chosen from the tribe of Judah. Chief of staff renamed them with Babylonian names. Daniel was called Belshazzar. Hananiah was called Shadrach. Mishael was called Meshach. And Azariah was called Abednego. And so we have Belshazzar, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But Daniel was determined not to defile himself by eating the food and wine given to him by the king. He asked the chief of staff permission not to eat these unacceptable foods. Now, God had given the chief of staff both respect and affection for Daniel, but he responded, "I'm afraid of my lord the king, whose order that you eat this food and wine. If you become pale and thin compared to the other young men your age, I'm afraid that the king will have my head." Find even here that even in the early parts of his life, even though there was a great apostasy among the Jews, that Daniel was well disciplined and he was well brought up. You know, the scripture, train up a child in the way he shall go. So Daniel spoke with the attendant who had been appointed by the chief of staff to look after Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. "Please test us for 10 days on a diet of vegetables and water." Doesn't sound very enticing to me, does it, do you? "So please test us for 10 days on the diet of vegetables and water. And at the end of 10 days, see how we look compared to the other young men who are eating the king's food. Then make your decision in light of what you see." And so the attendant agreed to Daniel's suggestion and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, Daniel and his three friends looked healthier and better nourished than the younger men who had been eating the food assigned by the king. And so after that, the attendant fed them only vegetables instead of food and wine provided for the others. Listen, as we look at this, sometimes our faith acts can become, in a sense, inconvenience. It can place us in inconvenient situations. Like, I don't know, maybe the boss has suggested you lie to keep your job. And so your faith has become an inconvenience, but not to you, but to him. Or when the guys, I've had this experience. I worked in the Jersey Parkway for a year before I went to seminary. When the guys at work start telling filthy jokes while you're standing there, I would walk away. I'd eat my lunch other places. I just wouldn't sit around and listen to it. So your faith can be, at a sense, an inconvenience to you, but it's not. It's an inconvenience to them. I think Jesus best describes our state in his prayer to the Father. John 17, he says, "I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I don't belong to the world. For I'm asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong in the world any more than I do." See, here's the reality. And Jesus was telling us in no uncertain terms that when it comes to relationship, our relationship and our purposes in God, we are aliens to the world because we're not of this world. We're aliens. Sometimes you may wonder, well, why don't I fit in with that group? It's because you're an alien to this world. We're strangers to this world because they don't understand our values, and they surely don't understand how we see things in a worldview. They don't understand what truly drives us and how we ultimately view things. We're different. You're different. George Shultz, who was the Secretary of State during the Reagan administration, kept this large globe in his office. And when an ambassador who was going to be assigned somewhere would come in, or if they came back from their assignment, he would have them go to the globe, spin it, and show us, where's your country? And so they would point to the countries that they had been assigned to or going to be assigned to. But his old friend, Mike Mansfield, was also appointed an ambassador. He was appointed ambassador to Japan. And he was even put to the test. This time, though, Mansfield put the globe, spun the globe, put his hands on the United States and said, that's my country. See, the secretary says, I've told that story subsequently to all the ambassadors going out. Never forget, you're over there in that country, but your country is the United States of America. You're there to represent us, take care of our interests, and never forget it. And you're representing the best country in the world. Listen, you must never forget that our home and our allegiance is to the kingdom of God. That's where our ultimate allegiance is. It doesn't mean we don't serve here. We don't put ourselves in situations where we're serving this country where we live. But our allegiance is to the kingdom of God. See, Daniel worked in a land that was hostile to the faith that he held. His bosses were some of the most powerful, most ruthless, and egotistical kings in all of ancient history. To contradict these men could even mean death. The book of Daniel is a record of the many times that Daniel and the three were placed in these inconvenient, uncomfortable circumstances where the odds against them were the highest. And it was in this atmosphere that Daniel stood firm with a non-negotiable faith. That's the title of my sermon this morning, A Non-Negotiable Faith. He knew what it meant to have his faith put him in some kind of inconvenient places. Daniel teaches that living with a non-negotiable faith was a matter of seriousness of subtle, even the subtle small choices that he would make. No one would blame him for eating the king's food. It was out of his hands, right? No one would have blamed him for putting his prayer life on hold. Faithfulness and devotion to God would mean, otherwise it would mean the lion's den. No one would have blamed him in the three Hebrews in chapter 3 of bowing just one time. What many believers must understand, what we must understand, that as an exception to the rules, these faithful men saw as non-negotiable. What they were called on was non-negotiable. You see, it's always the big decisions that determine the quality of your faith. It's not the little ones. A lot of little ones equal the big one. Matter of fact, being faithful in a lot of little decisions helps you make the big decision maybe even easier. And so can I just give you three things that I want to talk about here this morning about our non-negotiable faith, what Daniel teaches us. And the first is a non-negotiable faith means that you and I have established fixed loyalties. We've established fixed loyalties. We've approached it with forethought, with past action that have developed this foundation for us that was developed in Daniel's life. Even as young boys, I think Daniel and the three Hebrew children had established these non-negotiables in their lives far before they even were brought to Babylon. And non-negotiables are more than just a set of religious beliefs. It is a commitment to risk everything we have for the faith that we hold, no matter what. It's easy for us to say. But, God never calls us to do it alone, does he? That's why he's given us the Holy Spirit as our helper. His presence in our lives to help guide us and strengthen us. There's three things that I was thinking of when it comes to non-negotiables. It's non-negotiable about who is Lord. Who's in charge? It was immediately seen whose authority these Hebrew lives were submitted to. They were submitted to divine law, and divine law always for them superseded man's law, no matter what the cost. The Hebrew children refused to bow before anyone but Jehovah, and Daniel refused to stop bowing to Jehovah. In the reign of the Roman Empire, where Caesar was proclaimed as a deity, Paul wrote this in Ephesians 1. Listen to this. far above all principality and power and might and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and hath put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. He's talking about Jesus. That we need to settle in our hearts that no one will ever hold that kind of power or rule over our lives except Jesus Christ himself. We're committed to a non-negotiable truth. The Hebrew children refused to accept the rich diet at the king's table because God had shown them a higher principle to live by. The truth is that you believe, the truth that you believe is really the truth that you'll practice. The truth that you believe is really the truth that you'll practice. And for all of us, I think, you know what the real battleground can be in our lives is to have more faith at times in the perspective of man than in the principles of God. That's where the battle goes on within each one of us. It's included in the business. In the business world, it's okay to lie. That you have to look out for number one. And that you win through intimidation. We see that every day. We live in a culture, in a political world that is rampant with that. Thank God for Daniels who say, God's truth is a non-negotiable in my life. I choose to do things his way. Listen, this world may change, and it tries to change all the time. It tries to change us. But God's truth never changes. I work at McGraw High School, and I had somebody who worked there as well, that she had been a Catholic all her life. And she was ranting. She knew where I came from. She was ranting and raving to me about how the Catholic Church needs to change their doctrine when it comes to abortion and needs to change its different doctrines. I said, well, the whole point of a doctrine is it won't change. Because you won't have anything to believe in if you change the doctrines in light of what the world wants. Prophet had come into a city to minister to those who lived there. And at first, the people listened to his sermons, but they gradually drifted away until there was not a single soul listening to the prophet who spoke. So one day, a traveler had come through and said, why do you go on preaching? And the prophet said, in the beginning, I hope to change the people. If I still shout, it's only to prevent them from changing me. Here lies the struggle we face, the battle of not being sucked into the culture of this day. That's why you need to hold fast to the truth of God's word. And live it even when it's not convenient. And we also practice a non-negotiable grace. Daniel proved that his service to God was not for sale. Daniel was a servant of Jehovah first and the king next. He refused to even deviate from his devotional schedule to accommodate for the risk of at the risk of his own life. God is looking for men and women like Daniel who are sold out for him. Daniel proved that we can serve God without even neglecting our secondary commitments. Non-negotiables refuse to submit to the lie of situational ethics. It holds to the truth as absolute and practical in every situation. And you learn and grow by walking it out every day. Second thing is this. From Daniel, we find that a non-negotiable faith does not need to be confrontational. See, Daniel knew that the spirit in which he was doing things was wholly more important than what we do. Daniel knew that his faith could be an area of contention and confrontation, but he refused to approach it in a non-confrontational manner. Sorry. Notice how Daniel used tact to convince those to compromise their position just a little. Tact is the art of making a point without making an enemy. His protest had to be courteous as well as courageous. Hebrews 12:14 says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which men shall see the Lord. So listen, if we use our faith as a weapon of self-righteousness, Daniel learned to live peaceably in a world that was hostile to what he believed. Daniel wasn't motivated by his own personal ego to prove those around him as wrong. He wasn't motivated to defend God. He knew that God can speak for himself. And he did, didn't he? Daniel was only motivated by a desire to follow God and give him all the glory. See, when our motives are pure, we can live peaceably with men. We must check our motives before responding, obviously, to confrontational situations. His motives were solely based on honoring his God. And you know what? The Babylonians would understand that. And they could understand that. Because they were these religious people, and they religiously followed the advocacy of their gods. So why wouldn't Daniel and the three be any different to their God? Daniel knew that his faith could be an area of contention and confrontation, but he refused to approach it in a confrontational manner. He refused to approach it with an in-your-face kind of manner. And lastly, a non-negotiable faith embraces and accepts the consequences of our convictions. The consequences of our convictions. The three Hebrew children best exemplify that. When it says in Daniel 3, if we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. And even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gods or the statue that you set up for us. So they're thrown in the fiery furnace, and they look in, but there's four in the fire. There's four in the fire, not three. The presence of God was them in that fire. And a friend of mine just recently preached on this, and I like what he said. The only thing that burned in the fire were the ropes that bound their hands. See, even in the midst of the fire, God wants to take the ropes that bind you, the things that bind you, burn them up. And allow you to see his hand at work in you. You hear me this morning? The fire burnt the ropes, not the believers. No matter what the consequences, their faith stands as non-negotiable. Are you willing to have a faith even that costs you? God doesn't want you to go looking for that. But when it comes to meet you, will you be faithful to him? Cost Moses Pharaoh's palace and authority. Cost the Apostle Paul his position, his reputation. It cost Jesus his very life. It was recently, I just found this article. I read this, and maybe you've heard about it. Story of two NFL players from the world champion Kansas City Chiefs. One teammate was asked to come to a college graduation, and he chugged a beer, slammed it down at the graduation ceremony, and the NFL celebrates him. Harrison Butker talks about Christian values. He was at a conservative Catholic college. Talked about Christian values, getting married, raising kids at a graduation ceremony. And the woke NFL and the media tried to crucify the man for what he believed. And the man still stands. Still a kicker. Yeah. He wasn't afraid to share what he believed. We can listen to this morning as I'm about to close. We can only stand such a test when we value what we have more than what we lose. You hear? Just like that kicker for the Kansas City Chiefs. When we value what we have more than what we would lose. Does Jesus even describe that attitude in the parable about the pearl of great price? Told a story about a merchant who was looking for pearls. He found this one pearl, that was immensely worth a lot of money. So he sold everything except for that one little pearl, that one big pearl. The same thing with the gospel, the kingdom of God. We have a pearl of great price. And the willing to sell out everything for that. We will never effectively serve God until the kingdom of God is worth surrendering everything in our lives for. And that's a lifelong thing, isn't it? It's a lifelong pursuit. The surrendering, you know, I'm 70 years old. I don't look it, but I am. And that's why I'm going to be retiring in a year. But, you know, it's like every once in a while, the Holy Spirit will say, I want this. And I'll say, oh, I didn't know I didn't turn that over to you. And sometimes that, oh, is, it's like a nice thing. Something I've valued, but I want that. And it's far better to turn that over to him than for me to hold on to that. He does that to us all the time. Daniel and the three Hebrews valued the God they served more than their own lives. Second thing is we only stand such a test when we found the best way. Daniel had to be a firm believer that the path that God had put him on was the best path, and so must we. Where God takes you is the best path. Daniel trusted that path. He had accepted it, and it brought blessing into his life. All that life needs to be for us is wrapped up in a single package, and that's Jesus Christ himself. He's all the direction we ever need. He's the way. He's all the revelation that we ever need because he's the truth. He is all the fulfillment we ever need because he is the life. It's wrapped up in him. He's the way, he's the truth, and he's the life. Listen to the confusion of Thomas. And he says to Thomas, he says, "You know the way to where I'm going." "No, we don't, Lord," Thomas said. "We have no idea where you're going. So how can we know the way?" And Jesus told him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one can come to the Father except through me. If you'd really known me, you would have known whom my Father is. From now on, you don't know him. Now on, you do know him because you've seen him in me." And lastly, we can only stand a test like this when we know God is ultimately in control of my life. When we truly trust God, we're willing to put everything into his hands, even our lives. You can take a stand even when it costs you if you know without a doubt he is still in charge. Non-negotiable faith. After a forest fire in Yellowstone National Park, forest rangers began to trek up a mountain to assess the inferno's damage. One ranger found a bird, literally petrified by ashes, perched kind of like a statue on the ground at the base of a tree. Someone sickened by that eerie sight walked over and knocked over the bird with a stick. But when he struck that petrified bird, three tiny chicks scurried out from under your dead mother's wings. Psalm 91 says, and this is what I'll close. "This I declare about the Lord. He alone is my refuge, my place of safety. He is my God. I trust him. For he will rescue you from every trap and protect you from the deadly disease. He will cover you." I love this. "He will cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection." Listen to this again. "He will cover you with his wings. He will shelter you. He'll cover you with his feathers. He will shelter you with his wings. His faithful promises are your armor and protection." Don't be afraid of the terrors of the night, nor the arrows that fly in the day. Don't dread the disease that stalks in darkness. nor to the disaster that strikes midday. We're facing a whole lot of whatever in our nation right now. But you know what? I don't wring my hands like others do. I trust in God. He'll guide me how to vote. He'll guide me how to approach that. He will guide us through it. So even if things go the way we don't want them, he's still in charge. Because nothing, and I think we even shared that this morning during prayer. I think somebody said, he will never leave you nor forsake you. Just like those little chicks were covered by their mother's feathers in the midst of flame. Listen, you and I will experience fire when walking in faith. If you aren't right now, you will later on. And it's not meant to be negative, it's just to be a realist. There will be fires, not physical fires. Fires that we will face from time to time. I've been doing this a long time. And so I think I know what I speak of. But God has always taken me through the fire under his wings. And the word to you this morning is, God will take you through the fire under his wings. Can somebody come up and play the piano in the background? I should ask you earlier. I want to just give you a moment to respond to God's word this morning, because I think it's really important to respond to the word of God. Not to have an altar call for the sake of the one that's preaching. Altar calls for the sake of the one listening. Maybe you're facing a fire or have just come out of it. And maybe you're covered with some of that dust and dirt from the fire. Maybe it looks like there's fire in the distance. It says he will cover you with his feathers and hold you under his wing. This morning, if you close your eyes where you're at, I won't have you come up, but I would encourage you, if that's you this morning, in some way, just raise your hand to him and allow him to see. Yeah. All across the room, hands are up. Father, you see those that are just honest before you, facing situations and fires and all kinds of things that would try to usurp our faith, cause us to fret, fear, stumble, that would try to take the vision we have of you out of our hearts and our souls. But I know you won't stand for that. You didn't let that happen to Daniel. You didn't let that happen to Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, because you're in the midst of the fire. You're in the midst of their standing firm. They're in the midst of their not bowing to the world's statues. And some of us have jobs and places where maybe we're at being asked to do something that just doesn't go with our sense of who you are. Help us to be like Daniel, to be tactful without making enemies, to be faithful to you, and that the world around us, because of your presence in us, would see that we're different. There's been those situations where people will say, well, you're glowing. Yeah. It's because the presence of God is so real and manifest in us. And I pray that for each one of us. May the presence of Almighty God manifest itself in our lives, in our situations, in our decisions. And we thank you that you, above everyone else, would receive the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Mm-hmm. Thank you for being attentive. God bless you this Sunday.